Hey everyone, this is going to be the third video I'm doing on the Devil May Cry series, and naturally the topic for discussion here is Devil May Cry 3, with natural references to the previous two games in the franchise as well up until this point, Devil May Cry 1 and 2, and a few other elements of other Dante cameos, which I'll get into in a minute, because Dante was busy between these last two games. More importantly, however, this is about Devil May Cry 3, and it really was a return to form, and naturally, given the reception to Devil May Cry 2 that had been done in order to make for a bigger audience for the game, it actually backfired on Capcom, and it led them to kind of reevaluate how they wanted to make the Devil May Cry games. So a lot of influence here was taken from Devil May Cry 1 in regards to how the camera work works, how the gameplay works, and more importantly, how Dante is as a character. Devil May Cry 2 made a lot of changes, and they were keen to bring the character back into focus of what the original vision for him was, and Devil May Cry 3 has kind of led for perhaps one of the definitive versions of Dante in a much younger and at his most cockiest form, and much of that is helped by how he's portrayed and motion captured by Ruben Langdon, who puts in a fantastic performance, really defines the character from this point forward. So what did Devil May Cry 3 do exactly? Well, a return to both stylish action and survival action in a way, because the difficulty was amped up to be much harder than it was originally, and this was compensated in Japan by making the actual game slightly easier, and everyone outside of Japan got the default hard mode as the normal mode for the game. And so the game was known to be tough from the offset, and really most people, as long as they could play the game, were okay with that, because it's what Devil May Cry was expected to be, and this led into a game that was all around just much sharper, much funnier, much more gameplay eccentric, and yet had a lot more variation in how you would play the game as well. And let's look into that, but first of all let's look into what essentially has gone into making Devil May Cry 3. You see, between Devil May Cry 2 and 3, Dante had a number of cameos in other games, and this had led to a number of little cameos in various other franchises. Now, most notable of those cameos is going to be in Shin Megami Tensei Nocturne, or Lucifer's Call as it was called outside of the US and Japan. Now, Dante's use in Shin Megami Tensei was part of a deal that actually allowed the artists at Atlus to create the new Devil Trigger forms for Devil May Cry 3, and it actually makes for some of the most creative and cool looking devil forms, I think, in the entire series. Now, this wasn't the only cameo Dante made, because there was also a little known to the fighter called Beautiful Joe, a game that relied a lot on movie parody. Well, in that, Dante for the PS2 version was an unlockable character, and he had his own little story in which he essentially had to fight through the game to rescue Trish, as opposed to the main hero's journey of rescuing his girlfriend. Now, this brought a lot of Devil May Cry and what happened before into the parody sense, and self-referencing and just doing some stupid stuff like having Alistair as an actual boss in the game after his abandonment in Devil May Cry 2 actually has somewhat led into Dante's actual future growth, as well as looking at how they can make the series funnier. And I think Beautiful Joe, or Dante's portrayal in Beautiful Joe, has really led into the development of Devil May Cry 3's character for Dante. And while I don't know if that's exact, because I've also read reports that Ruben Langdon pretty much improvised his performance of Dante after confusing direction, it's interesting to think that the parody may have actually caused the series to go back in a different direction. And it's not that uncommon of a thing to happen in development for TV shows and games, where you get so far that really self-parody is the only way to move forward by stepping back, and that's what Devil May Cry 3 has done. I think fundamentally Devil May Cry 3 is a success because it actually follows the rules of Devil May Cry that I outlined in earlier videos, and this being the main two features of that. One, Devil May Cry 3 is wholeheartedly a game about Dante and Spada's family. It really deals with what happened in Dante's past with Dante and Virgil, and while it's a slight retcon on what was presented in Devil May Cry, it doesn't really matter too much. A book was actually written that details the original previous exploits, but it doesn't matter because what they've done in Devil May Cry 3 is make for a really engrossing game on top of the fun and stylish combat, and that's number two when it comes to the rules of Devil May Cry 3. The up close and personal combat. Everything is designed around keeping the enemies close and boxing you in, and having a camera that's focused on Dante at all times. Really, he is the star of the show, and he is the focus of the camera at all times as well, which makes that combat so much more refreshing when you see the gritty detail of everything that's happening. You're up close to see the attacks as they come and dodge and react to them from enemies, and you see those stylish combos as you pull them off. The slick, stylish combos are better than ever, and they are helped with brand new sound effects, really classy animations that really help with the visual effects on top to make those movements look even more stylish than they did in the original Devil May Cry. Everything has really taken a step up, and it just makes everything so much more refreshing to see yourself pulling off these things once you've mastered the combo system in the game. I want to say ironically, but probably not so much, Devil May Cry 2 perhaps had the least influence on the production of Devil May Cry 3. While you can see elements of its design in future Devil May Cry games, when it comes to Devil May Cry 3, it's probably got the least impact because it's a full-on return to Devil May Cry 1, and that is no way a bad thing. Garn was the team that made Devil May Cry 2, and everything was brought back to kind of be a proper homage, but also natural evolution of Devil May Cry 1 as well. But they also weren't afraid to break the mold as well. As I mentioned earlier with Beautiful Joe, but in this case as well, it's about taking what we know and love about Dante and representing it in a new way. Obviously, this is Dante as we've not seen him before, younger and cockier. The plot of Devil May Cry was actually relatively serious, with Dante obviously looking to avenge his family and kill Mundus, and it led for a much more downer tone and a mundane feel, even though Dante had his cockiness attitude. And we kind of get a retread of the original game, with Dante being stabbed by enemies as opposed to Trish, at least, but in a way that shows what we have here from Devil May Cry 1 as being honoured, but the reaction we're going to get to it is completely different. And let me show you exactly how that plays out.
Party's getting crazy. Let's rock.
Where we had Dante being cocky and cool, now we have over the top stylish Dante being younger, more cool, but also more fun. He enjoys his job, he enjoys what he does, he enjoys demon slaying, and as the player, or at least the watcher of the scene, you enjoy that with him as well, and it makes for a really magical scene that sets tone for the entire game. Even when it brings in the more serious aspects, it's not afraid to go over the top. And also the cutscenes themselves, with the motion capture being better than ever and the actual portrayal of the character being almost spot on now, it makes for just some engrossing cinematics when you're presented with them at the end of each scene. And like Devil May Cry 1 and Devil May Cry 2 as well, the amount of motion capture and the amount of action scenes we get outside of the actual gameplay are there, and really just make every scene much more fun as you see Dante's cockiness as he owns everything he comes up against, while also having a ton of fun doing it. So let's actually talk about the story of Devil May Cry 3. Now, perhaps it's unsurprising at this point because I've mentioned it quite a few times, this is a prequel taking place prior to the first Devil May Cry, and as such, we get to focus on the actual family, or at least the brothers, Dante and Virgil. It, for the first time, brings Virgil and puts him front and centre. It brings Dante and Virgil and puts their story into the actual limelight, once again against the backdrop of something else. But the start of the story is actually somewhat of a homage to the first Devil May Cry and how it's set up, with a mysterious stranger approaching Dante and setting up the plot from there for Dante to go and meet and fight Virgil, and along the way, and Dante finally gets to reconcile with Virgil in a kind of way by the end of the story. Virgil isn't so much the villain of the game, but there is very much a rivalry between the two brothers, while Virgil's complete obsession with power really leads him to be at odds with Dante. I imagine it's something they always had as children anyway, very much the rivals, and that's gone with them through life as Dante's tried to make a living and Virgil's gone on his journeys, which we find out more about in later games as well. Of course, Virgil has gone slightly over the top in this case, and he raises the giant tower that Dante has to then go and circumvent, and played up in a very reminiscent way of the first game as well in structure. So it's a mysterious place you have to actually go and work through, and you go back and forth working at puzzles to progress through the various missions of the game. There's nothing too much different here, except with how the bosses are structured through the story. There's so many more bosses, and for the first time we actually get to really look at some of the lore of Devil Arms as well, which I'll talk about in a second. But the bosses in Devil May Cry, you fight once and once only. You don't get a repeat of bosses over and over again, with the exception of Virgil, who works very much like he did in Devil May Cry 1. Dante faces him three times throughout the story, and it really does show a very good duality between the two of them, especially just how similar they are, and how Dante and Virgil are really both proficient fighters, and every fight with Virgil he uses a different weapon, which forces you to come at him from a slightly different way depending on the weapon he has and what its strengths and weaknesses are. Although it's not just Dante's journey as well throughout the game, you also have Lady, a mysterious demon hunter who uses a lot of guns, who he runs into, who's constantly at odds with him throughout the game, as well as you run into her every now and again. And Virgil, of course, has his own story too, as he attempts to unravel the mysteries of everything with his not-so-faithful servant Arkham, who you eventually fight as one of the main bosses, and he himself is probably the main antagonist of the story, controlling even Virgil's actions from clever manipulation behind the scenes by taking the form of a somewhat incompetent jester who hints Dante, well, in his regular form he pushes Virgil down the path ultimately to his own ends, and the jester as well is one of the crazy things that works so well about the game, and works so well when you realise the craziness that Arkham's actually gone to persuade Dante, whereas he is such a downbeat and deadpan character for the most part. It's just something you don't see, and even the jester as well is added as a boss in the latest special edition of the game as well, which again we'll talk about. But for the most part, the story and the gameplay remains very much faithful, along with its cutscenes. It's action, it's fun, and it's always over the top, and the cutscenes just go from strength to strength. They go through where the opening ones, where you see Dante's Devil May Cry get wrecked again, from the fight with Virgil, and every time he gets a new weapon after defeating a boss, the nice little scenes we see of Dante showing off his skills to no one in particular, but just because he can. Weapons themselves, we know, are once living demons for the first time, so even that is worked into some of the weapons in that they start talking while fighting and Dante has to shut them up, which is a clever little thing in detail and something I actually really appreciate in the game. But the gameplay overall is a fundamental departure from Devil May Cry 2, and obviously a massive upgrade from Devil May Cry 1. Everything is really returned to how it played in Devil May Cry 1 though, so it's all about the timing of your attacks. The bigger delays between your main weapon strikes allows you to go in different combos, which leads to a bunch of new and extra abilities and combos you can get depending on how long you're willing to wait, that risk-reward system that makes it so worthwhile. But you've also got the addition of so many more moves you can get to customise each weapon as well. But it's how the game actually flows between these weapons, because for the first time you're actually able to have two weapons equipped at any one time that you can actually switch between on the fly. You're not forced to use Dante's sword as well, it's not a regular and a sub weapon, every weapon is their own weapon in itself and you can use them however you like, and each weapon has completely distinct ways of being used. Obviously you've got the typical rebellion that was introduced in Devil May Cry 2 and now makes a return as Dante's signature weapon, and we'll do in every game from this point on. We also have the Cerberus, which is more like a nunchuck, have Agni and Rudra, which are fire and wind based dual swords, and Neva and the electric guitar. It's so ridiculously over the top that it's just fantastic. Of course, these different styles as well make way for some fantastic new actual animations to go with them as well. So much variety, and it makes the weapon combat look so stylish as you mix up between both the guns and the swords, which make a fantastic return, and you can also swap between guns at a moment's notice too. It means there's so much more possible variations you can do, and the stylish levels of combos you can pull off are absolutely fantastic. All this of course is ultimately helped by the camera as well, that now gets up close and personal with Dante and is always on him as well. You can see every little detail, and the latter HD versions of this game as well in their 60 frame glory look absolutely incredible when you're pulling all this stuff off. I think personally Devil May Cry 3 might be the best when it comes to the actual stylish look of the combat, with so many visual effects going on with the weapons as well as you use them, and the biggest variation of cool weapons really make everything really, well, just fantastic to watch on screen, especially when you know what you're doing and you're making all these things happen. You just flow from weapon to weapon, from strike to strike so effortlessly that the game after a while almost starts to play itself, and it's so fun when you just know every enemy, every weakness and every animation they have, so you can attack and counter as necessary. Of course, even then they've gone one step further by actually having styles as well. One of the buttons on the pad is dedicated to these styles, and to start off with you have four different ways you want to play the game. Swordmaster gives you more sword slinging techniques for your weapons, Gunslinger focuses that button on guns, Trickster allows you to have an extra dodge, which is a nice holdover from Devil May Cry 2, as well as running up the walls and really the parkour elements of that game that have been well implemented into Devil May Cry 3's combat, and of course Royal Guards for those who really like the risk reward system. If you can block at the right time, there's no need to dodge, you can counter and charge your meter to let everything back and really show how much power as well as how good you are at the game. And of course, as well, you've got one extra ability you get from a boss that allows you to make a duplicate of Dante on screen as well, and a second player can control him when you use your Devil Trigger. It's interesting and actually quite a bit of fun, and a nice little extra in a game that is really single player for the most part. I want to take a slight step back now though, and just talk about Devil Arms lore, because up until Devil May Cry 2, it was never a big thing. Obviously in the first game, Dante gained his Devil Trigger based on the weapon he had equipped. Now, there was a slight change to this in Devil May Cry 2 in that Dante had his own dedicated Devil Trigger form. This is something that will go on to become a much bigger thing in later Devil May Cry games, or more specifically the reboot. But Devil Arms are a fantastic idea, that they're demons that when defeated turn into weapons, or known as Devil Arms, and obviously they will have the elements of the demon they were beforehand. It's not always something they have control over. Some demons will willingly allow themselves to be turned into weapons, whereas some of them may subconsciously not realise they've been bested, but because they ultimately accept that they were beaten by a stronger opponent, they become Devil Arms and in the service of Dante, who beat them. But there's also that fascinating aspect, and this is where I actually think it's quite clever. Dante obviously changes his weapons throughout each game. He never really has the same weapons going into it, with the exception of Rebellion, which is a family heirloom. And it's an interesting way to put into the narrative that Dante doesn't really get attached to weapons, and he also has a business, and there's actually quite a big black market for Devil Arms, and between each game, all the weapons he finds he sells off and gets rid of, and even this will be a bigger plot point in the next game, but it's a fascinating idea that I really think is one of the few bits of Devil May Cry that I really like to work into the subculture of, and wish they did a little bit more with here and there in the main games, but Devil May Cry 3 doesn't really have the place for it. And it's just one more layer and element to the lore of the series that really Devil May Cry 3 really encapsulates well. So what of our characters in this game? Well, there's a bigger cast. Actually, it's possibly the biggest cast of characters up until this point in any Devil May Cry game. Obviously, our hero Dante is back. He's younger, he's cockier, he's badass, he's stylish, and he's the young Dante. He's possibly my favourite incarnation of Dante in the original four games, and someone who you can't help watch. He's just so enjoyable. He's contrasted though by his brother Virgil, twin brother at that, and obviously the hair is a distinction, and the fact that Virgil has a passion for blue where Dante has a passion for red. But Virgil really is the stoic. He's the antithesis of Dante in almost every way. Whereas Dante's the rock, Virgil's very much the hard place, and you see that no more than when they actually are fighting against each other, perhaps even more so when they actually work together. Every so often the Spada brothers will actually team up in aid of the common good, and this happens at the end of the game. For a little way they can actually look past their own differences and work together for a common good. It only happens once during the game, but it shows there's actually depth to them, and they do have a relationship of sorts. And even during that fight you get a nice little hint at the end of it to what their childhood used to be. It's interesting, and it's the big dynamic of Devil May Cry that I really wish more was focused on, and thankfully that does happen later. But Dante and Virgil are the quintessence of the Devil May Cry series, and I just want to see more of these two in a situation where they have to play off each other more. Obviously, Devil May Cry as a series is a single-player action game, and that doesn't happen as much. But there's just so much between these two that I really enjoy seeing, and I think Devil May Cry 3 might be the epitome of that in the earlier games, because they chose to make that the backbone of the story, once again amongst the potential annihilation of the world. Lady, on the other hand, is this game's version of Trish. She's a demon hunter, she's human, she has no powers. What she does have are guns, lots of guns. She does some really cool stuff with them. Her main weapon is a rocket launcher with a bayonet on it. So, Bayonetta, kind of in spirit maybe. But either way, she's really enjoyable and someone who is actually another fan favourite. Perhaps more can be done with her, but in all honesty, it's nice to have a relatable human character because there aren't any others in the game. Our main villain of the game, of course, next to Virgil, is Arkham, who obviously has his persona of the Jester as well, who you see. They're all working to the same goal, which is to essentially get Dante and Virgil to fulfil his needs, which is getting the two amulets together, raising the tower, and bringing misfortune onto the world. there's actually quite a mismatch of styles, with every character really having a distinct style that, while there's not much of them playing off each other, and Arkham himself is quite deadpan, so there's never really much interaction between the heroes and the villains outside of Dante and Virgil. Arkham is one though, and most predictably the secret guy who's working from behind the scenes to really push the events of the game into his benefit. Ultimately though, the whole point of him, I feel, is just to bring the brothers together against him, and really there's nothing wrong with that. So for that reason, perhaps, when it comes to Arkham as a main villain, I actually think the individual enemies you find in the game, specifically the bosses as well, perhaps have a bit more personality to them, especially some more than others. Our bosses in the game are absolutely brilliant. Obviously, you're going to get a hard knock from that difficulty curve early on with the first boss, Cerberus, who's the ice, well, typical god of the underworld. And while he isn't nearly as interesting as the other bosses in the game, Nevin is perhaps a very interesting vampire-like boss, but I think Agni and Rudra really make out as a dual boss that you have to fight. It's never been a case where Dante has to juggle between two really powerful opponents as part of a boss battle, and I think that boss might be one of the highlights of the game, next to obviously the main boss where you fight with Virgil or when you're fighting against Virgil. Virgil's boss battles are really the quintessence of the game, but perhaps the Agni and Rudra battle is the most entertaining. When it comes to our main enemies that we see from every day to day though, whereas Devil May Cry 2 had its Iron Maiden like enemies and its realistic machinery coming to life, and Devil May Cry 1 had its marionettes, I think Devil May Cry 3 strikes a kind of balance by having Grim Reaper like sand enemies that come out of nowhere and erupt into sand as well. That adds more style as you're knocking sand and dust out of these enemies as you go, and it just adds one more layer of feedback to the fight. As you see, you're really stripping these things apart swipe by swipe, and as an interesting contrast to Blood, I think it really works well. These things are so odd, you're literally slitting their neck and watching the dust fall out, and I think the metaphor works extremely well. So we should probably get around to talking about the actual world of Devil May Cry 3. Now, it does use things from both Resident Evil as well as Devil May Cry 1 and Devil May Cry 2, although it seems to be trying to learn more from where Devil May Cry 2 went wrong. However, what it actually does is quite clever. See, the original game and the second game, obviously never having really focused on Devil May Cry's or the actual office that Dante has, Devil May Cry 3 actually opens in the office. You start there and you have your first fight there, but it actually takes you onto the streets outside that general area. You get to see that Dante, perhaps unsurprisingly, has actually put his office near a strip club, and it actually allows you to go from there into the big tower where you'll be exploring the game. It doesn't just start you off there like Devil May Cry 1 did, and in doing so it actually allows you to see a little bit more of the world and actually transition you into that more creepy demonic-esque world you're going to be exploring for the majority of the game. You get to go up the street through the club and fight your way into there and fight the first boss, who's essentially the guardian of the tower, to get you in. And from that point you really start to see lots of crazy cool architecture and level design and really clever puzzles that are all matched in with this demonic landscape that is rotating and changing as it goes to make your progress change as you go through it, as you try to rise to the top and eventually try to explore it further. I think in this way it actually raises itself above what it did in Devil May Cry 1 and finally steps out perhaps under Resident Evil's shadow. It's not a carbon copy of the mansion, it's not trying to be what every Resident Evil game is in its latter half with the whole technical lab underground and such that Devil May Cry 2 did. It really is its own thing and it's focusing on it. It's crazy demon architecture, which is something that really just hasn't been tried, and it's actually rather refreshing. It makes Devil May Cry 3 really stand out on its own as well. In parallel to the other two games and what they did, you can really see how it uses them as homage, but takes each step further and really works out how to take it in a direction that makes it new, unique, and fun, as well as having interesting landscapes and environments like the streets, like the strip club and other demonic areas that really make combat interesting because you're forced to walk around them, as well as gameplay and attacks actually being able to be context sensitive to things in the environment as well, allowing you to have one more thing as part of your arsenal essentially. But one thing that sells the world more than anything else is the actual audio of this game. I think it's quite arguable that Devil May Cry 3 has the greatest soundtrack, and it really mixes the mega rock that really encompasses who Dante is as a character now. But it also pushes it with some really great organ-like religious tones that give you to the opening of the game and reinforce how it's setting itself up to be like Devil May Cry 1 before offshooting into the comedic horror action of Devil May Cry 3's main theme. You get a fantastic organ-like opening to the game that overplays Dante and Virgil fighting, which is from the Mission 7 fight. but it again just leads you into watching that and then the opening of the very first cutscene before everything really goes off the rails with Dante's personality. It's absolutely brilliant how it takes you in, but it also brings these themes back when it comes to fighting Virgil and other more somber plots of the game, like when you hear more about Lady's backstory. But most of the time you're hearing the hard rock action, and that perfectly encapsulates what the game is trying to do with its combat and just makes it even better when you're fighting, pulling off fantastic combos and hearing some awesome music to go along with it as well. Going off on a small tangent here, perhaps one of the things I've always wanted the Devil May Cry games to do, and is something they don't do, is audio feedback on the actual attacks. And obviously you get really cool special effects, but the sound doesn't change, and if you look at something like Remember Me, the French-made action-adventure game, or something like Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, where the sound actually changes to keep in with going into the cutscenes. Something, perhaps having a similar system like this that actually has the sound amp up, maybe even to what they do in the recent Killer Instinct reboot, would really make those combos feel more earned as you've got more music feedback based on what you are actually doing. It's just an idea, but it's something that I really think would benefit the Devil May Cry combat system and really amp up the feedback you got from pulling off awesome combos. Of course, it's not just the actual music, but the sound effects as well, and the voiceovers to an extent too. The sound effects sound best than ever and really make that visual feel of ripping something made of sand apart. Every little clash really makes it feel alive, and it feels so much better quality-wise than what was in the first two games. But I think this is helped because of the overlaying of voices actually on top as part of the combos too. Dante will actually exclamate words as part of his combos, and sometimes this will be talking to his sword, sometimes this will just be simple things like shouting breakdown at the end of a combo. But it really works again in getting the feedback once you've pulled off a particularly tricky maneuver or done something awesome to end your combo. You'll get another line of feedback, and I think voices always trump sound effects in that kind of way, and especially in Dante's case when he's being voiced so well.
No talking. Good.
And of course that brings us to the voices as well. While Ruben Langdon plays Dante, and he plays him absolutely brilliantly, I think his personality also moves into the performance as well. But I don't think without Virgil, played by Dan Selworth of Power Rangers fame, would be nearly as fun as well if he wasn't the perfect counter to how Ruben Langdon acts Dante. They play off each other so well because they are so completely at dead opposites to each other, and it's something that really works when the two are fighting or talking, and it makes it one step more when the characters are on screen together, and perhaps for that reason there's not nearly enough interaction between the two brothers in the game, which is a small downside, but you do get a fair bit, and ultimately when they are working together it's brilliant. And as we're talking about Virgil and Dante at the moment, this brings us neatly onto the special edition of the game. Devil May Cry 3 started the tradition in the series of having re-released special editions that add more onto the game than what the original base game had, and the one for Devil May Cry 3 added Virgil as a playable character, giving him a full kind of pseudo campaign. He had his own intro and outro cutscene, but beyond that, there's nothing really you're doing special in the story, you're just retreading Dante's steps playing with Virgil. But he has a lot of gameplay tweaks that make him a completely different ball to play with than Dante. He has three weapons that you can change between on the fly, and these are the ones you fought against him when he was using in the main game for each of his battles. So you have his Yamato sword, you have the Beowulf, and you have the Force Edge, which is the sword Dante goes on to inherit in Devil May Cry 1 as well, which is a nice little bit of canon actually and works really well. And it also means that Virgil is actually perhaps more open with his combo options than Dante is at any one time, because he has three weapons to choose from. But he's very light on the gun side, because Virgil doesn't actually choose to use guns. He does have his summon swords though, which he has as Nello Angelo, and that's something you can put into your combos either by summoning them one by one or summoning them around you so you can use them at any point as kind of a shield that slashes enemies and adds to your combo meter all the time. Along with that, there was actually boss battles added with the Jester, who wasn't actually fightable in the original game, but now there's three fights with him like there are with Virgil. Only the first one's actually mandatory though, as they get harder and harder throughout the game if you choose to go and fight him more and more. But it's a nice little bit of fan service, because he was the one character in the game that people really wanted to fight, although narratively it doesn't actually make much sense to do that. It's kind of interesting, and well, it's fan feedback, and If anything, that's one thing the Devil May Cry series does seem to be doing rather well when it comes to Devil May Cry 3, and that's giving the fans what they want, and so no arguments there. On top of that, we also have the standard extras as well you get for the post-game completion, so you've got Bloody Palace mode, new costumes. They've retweaked the difficulty for the special edition as well, incorporating the Japanese version's gold orbs, whereas the European and American version had yellow orbs. They function slightly differently. They both deal with revivals, but the yellow orbs made you restart the level, whereas gold orbs revived you on the spot. And the game is a lot better for having the option to revive on the spot. Also, the difficulty options are slightly tweaked as well, and the special edition overall is just a lot easier. However, it's still very much a crushing game in general. The gold orbs, however, just give you a nice little leg up to really help, which is good when so many people never really made it past the third level Cerberus boss because of how difficult it was in the American and European versions. I suppose the legacy of Devil May Cry 3 is that it's really the favourite game in the series for most fans. It's certainly the most entertaining, and I think when it comes to raw strength of plot, as well as being fun and an action-adventure game that has all the style, it really trumps most of the other Devil May Cry games. I'm not ultimately sure if it's my favourite of the series, but perhaps it's the one I've certainly gone back to the most over time. I really like Devil May Cry 3 because it's fun, and an action game that has a lot of difficulty but can also be fun is something that would inherently grab me all the time and makes me want to rewatch those cutscenes all the time to see Dante do his most cockiest things. The interaction he has with almost everyone in the game is fun because Dante himself is fun. He's light-hearted, but he's serious when it needs to be for the plot reasons as well, but that never overshadows what they're trying to do, make an engrossing action-stylish adventure, and they do that extremely well. Ultimately, I think the series takes a bit of a downstep from here because something that's received so well, even though Devil May Cry 3 is no means perfect, it's very hard to follow up, and I think they've struggled with a lot of that over time. They didn't know quite where to go from reinventing the wheel again for Devil May Cry 3 when it came to Devil May Cry 4. Everything goes off the rails a little bit, and it makes Devil May Cry 4 a real disappointment to me. Not that it doesn't do a lot of things right, perhaps it just does more unfortunately wrong, taking the wrong lessons from Devil May Cry 3. But we'll talk about that next time. Perhaps Devil May Cry 3 is the one game in the series that they should play if they've never played Devil May Cry games before. It's the most enjoyable, it's the most fun, and it starts at the very beginning of the timeline, which is a great way to jump into the character for the first time. Also on top of that as well, it has the fun that it needs to be an enjoyable game. And it has parody as well, and it's not afraid to make fun of the world it's in, which is great, and it's something as an extension. I'd also suggest people try Dante's campaign in Beautiful Joe for that same reason, if you've not tried that. But there you go, Devil May Cry 3, and I really, really love it as a game. And I hope you'll come back and semi-enjoy Devil May Cry 4 with me on my next video. See you guys.
I'll try it your way for once.
Remember what we used to say?
Jackpot.